Today, we are going to be talking about Google Jamboard teaching tips. For those of you who aren't as familiar with Google Jamboard, it started as a physical smart board that you could actually purchase. So a Jamboard was a physical item you could have in your classroom. There's a web version now, and there's even a Jamboard app for iPad. One reason why I'm hopeful that they'll continue to add new features to the web-based version is because the physical Jamboard already has a lot more features and functionality. We'll talk about how we can use Google Jamboard for intro type activities in your engage phase of the lesson to kick lessons off with a whole group interactive activity. We'll look at how you can use Jamboard in the middle or end of a lesson sequence to have students review or share out what they've learned. And also show you some different tricks like how to set up different backgrounds by pulling them in from other programs. And I'll show you how to do some little other little tricks like how to set it up for small group work, how to set it up so it just gets sent to an individual, but you could use that for a digital interactive notebook. Let's jump over here and get into Google Jamboard. You can check it out by going to jamboard.google.com. This will show you all the recent, what they call jams, that you created. And then you can also go down here to the orange plus to add a new one. What I'm going to do to start is just show all the basic features here about how to use Google Jamboard, and I'm going to progress in complexity over the course of the show. On the left-hand side here, you'll see that you have some different tools, and this is something to watch out for because they keep adding new tools here. So this top tool here is a pen tool. I'll show you how this could be useful later when you just have students do things like circle ideas that they like or put check marks by things, stuff like that. Below it is an eraser tool. So this can be used to erase what was already done. A select tool. If you have an image or you have something that you've put on here, it allows you to move that kind of stuff around. One of the tools that I use quite often is the sticky note tool. You can write down to start a lesson what you would want students to do. You can change the color, post it, and then this becomes an interactive piece that you can drag all around wherever you want it to go, make it as large as you want it. And you can also easily duplicate these. There's also an image tool. So adding an image will allow you to pull images in from your computer. You can pull images. You can take a picture of yourself. You could pull images in from Google. You can pull them in from photos if you've uploaded those into your Google photos. This is more of a cosmetic thing, but if you lay those over each other, you'll see that with the order button here, or the order option, you can bring this to the front. So that would lay the sticky note on top of the image. Shapes, you could do something like add a square and bring that square in. And then you could continue to bring those squares, either, you know, making your own or duplicating them. And then you could label it at the top so that students know what to do for that particular part of the graphic organizer. The shapes are, you know, to me a little bit less important now that you can actually just bring in your own background. Big addition, the ability to add a text box. With the text box, you can click where you want it to go and then actually type inside of Jamboard. And of course, you have some options for, you know, the size. You can drag it around wherever you want it to go, things like that. This is one as well, the laser tool, where you can do things like point to the place that you want to draw students' attention to as well. There's an undo tool. There's also a zoom tool. So this allows you to zoom in or zoom out, things like that. The background tool we're going to look at in just a moment. These are basic backgrounds that have always been here. So you can do things like add graph paper and line paper, or at least been there for a while. What's new is relatively new is this ability to bring in a background image. Clear the frame would just wipe everything and allow you to start fresh again. You can very easily just add new pages. So you just add new pages by creating a new frame. You can see I can basically add just unlimited amount of frames here. There are some options that are useful here. One is the ability to download this as a PDF. Also to save the frame as an image. You can also make a copy, and I'll be showing you how to use that, particularly if you want to create a template and copy it over and over again. As I just want to start right here by showing some different ideas about how you could use this at the beginning of class. You can ask students to do things like make connections to prior knowledge or prior content. Here, students would be sharing what's something that you already know about this subject. You might also want to have students make predictions. So let's say you're reading a class novel and you're in the middle of the book. You could start class by asking students to make a prediction about what they think is going to happen next. You can also ask students to do things like quote analysis. And then another way that I like to potentially start off a lesson or lesson sequence would be to bring in an image and have students make inferences about that image. They could make predictions about that image as well. Let's actually look at what it would look like now if I pull in a student. I am going to show how to actually push this out and assign it through Google Classroom in a minute. But another option is that you just directly share Google Jamboard with them. So you can either share Jamboard as a viewable file, or you can share it as editable. If you want to share it first as viewable, you can do that. If you just want to teach on Jamboard, then give edit access and then switch right back to view access, you can do that. One is that you could just change to anyone with the link, and then you can get this copyable link that you can share. If you want students to actually be able to get in here and participate, which you probably want, then you're going to need to change this to editor. You probably want to do something like set up a class list in Google Contacts. And I don't have time to show that in this show, but you can, in Google Contacts, you could just create a class list. So all you would type would be Mr. Carey's sixth grade class, and then your whole student emails would populate in. You could copy and paste your email list from Google Classroom or from another place where you have student emails. But this will give you a little bit higher level privacy for the students that are coming in. You might want to do view only to start if you're doing some explanation. So, you know, kind of the rule of like, you don't pass out the papers on student desks while you're still talking, because then they're going to start working on something and they're just going to be watching you at this point. Now, when you want the student to actually be able to edit it, you just need to change the permission. So you go back here to share, and you're going to change Dan's permission level to be an editor. It's going to show up on his page. And if it doesn't show up automatically, you can just ask him to refresh it. And then Dan will be able to get in and he could do things, you know, like add a text box or drawings or any of the tools that I just showed you as well. A couple of tips about using Google Jamboard. One, that you do toggle back and forth between view and edit. Another suggestion is that you use it for the most part for this type of activity, for just like a quick check-in activity. And it's not something where you're using it when you have everybody in it as a big open workspace. Set it up so that it's smaller groups, you know, think strategically about the groupings so that they're going to be respectful about that. One thing that I did also want to show here that most people probably don't know about is that little gear icon. So if you go up here to the gear icon, let's say that you do have Dan as an editor. I would recommend that you take off editors can change permissions and share. And you probably also want to take this one off. Viewers and commenters can see the option to download, print, and copy. And this will give you a little bit of higher level admin access so that students can't do all the things that just an admin owner of the Jamboard would be able to do. One reason, I should say, why Jamboard is more powerful now is the ability to set a background. So for example, you could go to Canva, and then when you log in, they have pre-made templates. Now, you can actually do these directly in Canva. I don't have time to show that here, but you could bring all your students in and have them actually work on these directly in Canva. But another thing you can do with these pre-made whiteboard templates is download them and bring them into Jamboard. And you can actually bring that animation in. I know I'm going to offend half the audience by calling this a GIF or a GIF for the other half. You just want to change the file type here to GIF or GIF and then download that file. What you can do is go back to Jamboard, and then you can go to Set Background, click Image, and then you're just going to find that on your computer. Click open. That's kind of fun, and I think adds a layer, you know, to Jamboard that makes it a lot more interesting. Then he'll be able to write directly on top of this background. And I think this would be particularly useful idea for, say, elementary students. You could basically tell them who needs to post on a space. So for example, you know, we could put the names of students rather than these other prompts. And then once you download this and bring that in, these would show up as backgrounds so that students would know, oh, I need to put my sticky right on top of that. A little bit more advanced way to use this, which would be to start using it for small group work. What you would do is, again, we're going to check out some of these templates here. You can find a template. We'll bring in this one, which is essentially like a project planner where they have to write their team name and goals and potential risks. And again, you could change all of this so that it applies to a particular project. Bring this in. This is going to be essentially my master copy. What I'm going to show you is actually going to work best if you're able to split your class into four groups. What I'll do here to make this available to groups is go up to the three dots and I'm going to click make a copy. And I'll just change this one now to be group two. And I'm just going to replicate this process basically over and over again. Now what I'm going to do is use a screen splitter to be able to see all four boards at the same time. You can bring in Jamboard and Google Classroom. So here I'm going to add this from Google Drive. And I should be able to find this in my folder. Then here you would want to change student can edit. Do is go up here to my students, and I'm just going to assign this to the students that are in this group. Also repeat this process for the other boards. What I'm going to do is I'm going to click shift on these four tabs up here. Then I'm going to go over to tab resize. So when you click it, then it's going to now show you all four. Now I just want to talk very briefly about some other ways you can use it in the middle of a lesson. Let's say that we all just learned about a topic. We went out and watched some Ed Puzzle videos and read some Actively Learn articles. And now we need to start organizing those ideas because we're going to be using them to fill in a graphic organizer, to make a digital comic, or write an essay or something like that. One way to make sure that that's equitable and everybody has the information and is learning from each other would be to pull in something like this where you're coming back as a check-in. What did you learn? You're doing some mini lesson. You could also use Google Jamboard for digital interactive notebooks. Google Slides is not an open canvas, right? You cannot just like write anywhere on it with the same level of ease. Huge fan. I love Slides Mania. One of the template types that she has been making are these notebook style templates. This is one of them that I downloaded from Slides Mania. What you can do with these is download these as an image and then bring them into Jamboard. And I will bring that background in. I can look at these different template types and I can start to edit them. Go to Google Classroom. You can assign a Jamboard template out to students as an individual copy. Okay, so I'm going to go to create assignment and I'll write whatever instructions I want. And then I'm going to go to add Google Drive. Then I'm going to find that in my Drive recents folder here. Every student now has an individual copy of the notebook. You'll see that you have a folder that you can access again right here from your Class Drive folder. You'll be able to see all the Jamboards that have been created for your students. This gives you a way to see them, to be able to click inside of them and check them out. You also want to continue to push more of the slides out to students as, say, an ongoing notebook. You could have them all kind of set them up on their own where all they're doing here is just setting a background, it's some paper, and you're giving them a prompt. Another option would be that you could have your main copy, and what you could do is have this built out and you continue to add new slides to this, what you can do is go to create, pull in this slide deck as view only, and then leave it without a theme. So this file, I can constantly be adding new slides to. It will show up at the top of Google Classroom, and you can basically just train students and teach them proactively for a while that they would open that slide deck. When they open it, they'll have it as a view only slide deck, so they would not be able to edit them. And then you can teach them how to go file, download, JPEG. They have this new frame. Maybe you put a new writing prompt on there. And then when they go into their own personal notebook, you just show them how to add that new page in there. It is an effective way to encourage everybody in the class to participate and really set up that culture of mandatory participation in your class.